Tonight, we're continuing our study of issues facing the local church. This evening, we're looking at the necessity of commitment. A fundamental commitment on the part of each member of the congregation is absolutely vital for the well-being of that congregation. Commitment on the part of each member is absolutely necessary in order for the church to be what God would have it to be, and in order for us to do what God would have us to do. So we're thinking then about how important commitment is to the local church. But first and foremost, as we think about the necessity of commitment and how vital it is to not only the congregation but each individual, we need to understand what commitment is. We need to understand what commitment involves. The word commitment means devotion. To be devoted to a person or to be devoted to a cause. And indeed, you and I are to be committed or devoted to Jesus Christ. We are to be committed to the cause of Christ. We're to be committed to the work of Christ. We're to be committed to the church. For the next few moments, we're going to be looking at a number of different areas in which you and I, as members of the local church, are to truly be committed. Let's think about this for a few moments. First of all, we must have a commitment to Bible study. We must have a commitment to Bible study. In order for us to be strong spiritually, in order for our faith to grow, we have to spend time with the Word of God. And we all understand that, and we agree with that. In Romans 10 and verse 17, Paul says, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." We must have a hungering and a thirsting for righteousness, a hunger for the Word of God. Our attitude toward God's Word is to be the same as the blessed man of whom we read in Psalm 1 and 2. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Yes, we need to spend time with the Word of God. What makes a strong congregation? Well, I believe we would all agree that in order for the congregation to be strong, each individual who makes up that congregation must be strong. And so we think then about the strength of the individual members and what we need to do in order to grow spiritually and in order to be strong as the Lord wants us to be. In Ephesians 6 and verse 10, Paul says, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." Then he goes on to list the different parts of the Christian armor. And if you and I have on these different parts of the Christian armor, then that will enable us to be strong and to overcome the devil, to overcome the wiles of the devil. Peter writes in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18, "But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." Now who would doubt that the Lord requires us to be strong? And you read of that over and over again. There's so many different scriptures that emphasize the truth that the Lord wants us to be strong spiritually. And in order for us to be able to overcome the devil, and in order for us to truly do the work of God, we must be strong. Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 2 and 2, "As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby." I'm well aware of the fact that Peter is discussing newborn babes in Christ, that is, new Christians. But my friends, the principle is true, no matter whether you've been a Christian five days, 5 years, or 50 years, and that is that growth comes through a study of the Word of God. We must spend time with the Scriptures. Why? The Word of God is as vital to our spiritual growth as food is to the physical body. And we need to understand the need to spend time with God's Word on a daily basis. And you see, in order for us to do that, then we need to be committed to it. We must have a commitment to Bible study. We need to have the mindset or the attitude that I'm not going to let a day go by that I'll not spend some time reading and studying from the words of eternal life. And that's what the Scriptures are. On one occasion in John chapter 6, we read that Jesus was teaching his disciples some things that they considered hard to be understood. And instead of continuing to follow the Lord and listening to Him expound upon these spiritual matters, the Scripture says that from that time on, many of them turned away and walked no more with Him. Then it was at that point that Jesus turned to His immediate disciples and He asked them the question, "Will ye also go away?" It was Peter who replied, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life." Yes, we must be committed to a study of the Word of God. But let's think for a moment about our Bible classes in the local church. We need to have a commitment also to our Bible classes. Let me ask you something. Are Bible classes really important? Do they accomplish anything at all? Well, to hear some members in the congregation, many members throughout the brotherhood, or to simply observe them, you would think that Bible classes are not important, that they don't accomplish anything, that they're not really necessary. Because throughout the brotherhood, in many congregations, there are those who see little or no need in attending Bible classes, whether it be on Sunday morning or Wednesday evening. But here's what you and I need to do. We need to think about the advantage of Bible classes and what advantages do they offer? What can they do for me as a Christian, as a child of God? Well, first of all, I need to understand that I will get out of a thing only what I put into it. So I need to put my whole heart into anything that I do, especially when it comes to my life as a Christian. Now, first of all, Bible classes reinforce spiritual growth. As I've spent time daily reading and studying from the Word of God, and then I have an opportunity on Sunday morning to come together with my brothers and sisters in Christ to again study from the Word of God, and again on Wednesday evening to meet with my fellow Christians and study together from the Scriptures, it reinforces my spiritual growth. It reinforces what I've been doing every day of the week by way of reading and studying from the Scriptures. Not only that, but in our Bible classes, we have opportunities to study various and sundry topics from the Word of God, various subjects from the Scriptures. We have opportunities to do a systematic study of the Bible as we look at different books of the New Testament and perhaps even the Old Testament. We have opportunities in our Bible classes to ask questions. As I'm reading and studying through the week, or reading and studying from the material that we're going to be studying in class, I may have different questions, and so I can write those down. And then, as we meet together in our Bible classes, I can ask those questions, and I can be enlightened. In our Bible classes, we have opportunities for interaction among the different class members, and as we discuss the Word of God, that helps me also. So you see, there's so many different advantages to Bible classes. And I need to be committed to those classes. In order for me to be strong spiritually as a child of God, and in order for the congregation to be strong, every member needs to have a commitment to Bible class. But then we need to have a commitment to each other. Yes, we need to have a commitment to each other. In the long ago, Cain asked the question in Genesis chapter 4, verse 9, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Cain had killed his brother Abel, and he was confronted by God about the matter. And when God asked him, "Where is Abel, thy brother?" then he responded, "Am I my brother's keeper?" So think about that question for a moment. Am I my brother's keeper? Am I my sister's keeper? Well, in a spiritual sense, the answer is yes. I am my brother's keeper in the sense that I have a responsibility toward my brothers and sisters in Christ. If you doubt it, look to the Scriptures. Look at the church in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 2, on the day the Lord's church was established. In Acts 2, starting with verse 44, all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men as every man had need. They were concerned about each other. They cared about each other as brothers and sisters in Christ. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 25 and 26, Paul says that the members of the body should have the same care one for another. Whether one member suffer, then all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, then all the members rejoice with it. And the point there is that the different members of the body are to care for one another. They are to be concerned about each other. This also is set forth in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. And let us consider one another unto to provoke and to love and to good works. Let's consider each other. Stir one another up unto love and to good works. That teaches that we're to be concerned about each other. We're to encourage each other. A Hebrew writer writes in Hebrews 3 and verse 13, exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Exhort one another, encourage each other. What if a brother or sister becomes weak? What if a brother or sister is overtaken in a sin? Well, listen to the words of Paul in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. And so if one is overtaken in a fault, then we are to be concerned about that brother or sister. We are to work to reclaim him, to bring him back to the fold of God, to restore him to his first love. And we do that because we're committed to him. We're to have a commitment to each other. But then, as we think about commitment, we're also to be committed to the financial obligations of the church. We're to be committed to the financial obligations of the church. Think first about the work of the church. You and I are to be involved in the work of the church. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now, when you look at that verse of Scripture, there's only one conclusion you can come to. And that is, the Lord desires and requires his people to be involved in his work, in the work of the church. Now, yes, we all have different abilities. We have different talents. And 1 Corinthians chapter 12 covers that. What I may be able to do, you may not be able to do. You may have a talent, an ability that I do not have. But we are to use whatever abilities we have to promote the gospel of Christ, to spread the gospel of Christ, to build up the local congregation. And let me tell you something. One of the great things about being involved in the work of the church is that there is no work that an individual does for the Lord that is ever in vain. Think about it. There may be 3, 4, 5 people that I'm trying to teach the gospel to. And it may be the case that not a single one of them is receptive to the message of the gospel. It may be that not a single one of them is interested in continuing to study and obeying the gospel. And I may walk away and think, well, I failed and I am discouraged over that. Well, let me tell you something. I may not have the desired result, that is, their obedience to the gospel. But have I really failed? No. The work that I do for the Lord is not in vain. 1 Corinthians 15, 58. It is never in vain. Because I've done what the Lord wanted me to do. I've done exactly what he requires me to do. So it's not in vain. But let's think about the financial obligations of the church. And that's what this main point is about. I have an obligation, I have a responsibility to contribute to the work of this congregation through financial means or monetary means. 1 Corinthians 16 verse 2 says, upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. Well, it's a great thing to know upon the first day of the week when we give of our means that we're contributing to the work of the church, that we have a part in carrying the gospel to others, whether it be in this community or beyond to other parts of the world. It's a great thing to know that and to know that we're participating in that from a monetary standpoint. But what if I must be absent on any given Lord's Day? Does my responsibility continue even if I'm absent? Well, let's think about it this way. If I'm absent from work at my secular job, we know that our financial obligations are going to continue whether I'm able to work or not. I may be sick for a number of days. I may be sick for a week or 2 weeks and unable to work, but my financial obligations continue. I still have a mortgage payment. I still have perhaps an automobile payment. I still have a light bill, a utility bill. Those things continue to come regularly. And so I continue to have that obligation. Now, what about the work of the church? Let me tell you something, my friends and brethren. Whether I am present or not, the financial obligations of this congregation continue, whether I'm here or not. If I'm sick and unable to be present on any given Lord's Day, the financial work of this congregation continues, even if I'm not here. If I am away on vacation, the financial responsibilities of this congregation continue. So, can I continue to have a part in that? Should I continue to have a part in that? Well, the answer is yes, absolutely. Because as a member of this local church, I have that responsibility. So what can I do? Well, if I'm sick on a particular Lord's Day, then I can double up on my contribution the next Lord's Day. Or if I'm out of town, I can leave my contribution with someone, or I can double up on my contribution when I return. And in so doing, I'm continuing to meet my responsibility as a member of that local church in supporting the work of the church financially. But then finally, we must have a commitment to worship. We must have a commitment to worship. Why are we here? Well, some may point to Hebrews 10, verse 25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is. So some may point to that and say, well, we're here because we're commanded to be. Well, there is a command involved in Hebrews 10 and 25. But is that the only reason that we're here? In Matthew 22 and verse 37, Jesus says, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. Now that translates into loving God with the totality of our being. And if I love God with my whole being, there is nowhere else that I would rather be than with my brothers and sisters in Christ to worship Him, to praise Him, and to magnify His high and holy name. There's nowhere else I would rather be. Worship is indeed a privilege. And each individual Christian has a responsibility to worship God as He directs in His Word. In John 4, verse 24, Jesus says, God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Now, there are a number of things that you would learn from that verse of Scripture. One is you have the requirements for acceptable worship there. That is, worship must be done in spirit, that is, from the heart, in sincerity. It also must be done in truth. To worship God in truth is to worship Him according to the way that He directs in His Word. So we learn that from that verse of Scripture as well. But we also learn that each individual member has a responsibility to worship God. It's not that God needs something from me. I need Him. And God has designed our worship to Him, and He designed it in such a way that when we worship Him according to His Word, that we're going to receive spiritual benefits from that. I'm going to be drawn closer to Him. I'm going to be strengthened spiritually. I'm going to be drawn closer and closer to my brothers and sisters in Christ. And those are some of the spiritual benefits. And I'm to be committed to worship. That means come Sunday morning, you can count on me to be present because of commitment. But when I leave the building after our morning worship, there's no question in my mind but that I'll be back on Sunday evening. Why? Commitment. Come Wednesday evening, when we have an opportunity to come together to study from the Word of God again, there's no question in my mind but that I will be present. Why? Commitment. And if we're having a gospel meeting, there's no question as to whether or not I'll be present during those times that when the gospel is being preached in that evangelistic effort. Why? Because of commitment. There's also an added commitment for those who lead in worship. And I'm talking about those who lead in prayer, those who lead singing. And when it comes to our men who lead us in prayer, you have to give serious thought to the prayer before you ever get before the congregation. What am I going to say by way of directing our minds in prayer? What am I going to say to God on behalf of this congregation? I'm to give thought to that, to prepare. And when it comes to our song leaders, and we have some excellent song leaders here at Lawson Road, think about the importance of leading singing. These men have a great responsibility to select songs that they make and make certain that those songs are in harmony with what the Scriptures teach, and choose songs by way of edifying us and enabling us to teach and admonish one another through these songs. Colossians 3:16. Our teachers are to be committed. They're to be prepared as they teach their students. And then those of our men who lead in devotionals on Wednesday evening, there's that added level of commitment. Be committed to that work as well. Make sure that you're prepared. Commitment is absolutely vital in order for the church to be what God would have it to be. Commitment on the part of each member is absolutely necessary in order for the local church to do what God would have us to do. My friends and brethren, let's truly be committed. If you're here and you're not a Christian, we encourage you to obey the gospel of Christ. Peter instructed those on Pentecost in Acts 2 and verse 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. If you're an erring child of God, your need then is to be restored to your first love, to rededicate your life to Christ and His way of life for you. If you're subject to heaven's invitation.